the way you shape a culture is by living out the message of shalom in your marriage, in your family, in your business, in your recreation. And as others see it, like the prisoners in the jail, they're drawn to God.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, we're always excited and privileged to spend a little bit of time with Ray, affectionately known as RVL, Ray Vander Laan.
Yeah, you know you're part of the family when there's
right.
a nickname.
So we may refer to Ray as RVL throughout this discussion. He uses his unique gifts to look at ancient culture, and he helps us to apply it to our lives today, which is, I think, what God wants us to do, not just read passively, but to understand what the Scripture is saying, and how should that work into my heart, and I apply it to the culture around me. So I'm always excited when Ray is here, because this is an interest to me, and I would hope it's an interest for every one of us who claim the name of Christ. Ray is the founder of That the World May Know Ministries and host of the video series. This man comes with experience.
Yeah, and for those who don't know, Ray is a religion instructor at Holland Christian Schools in Holland, Michigan. It's a great place, and they're very glad to have him there, and he influences
are.
So many people.
Ray, welcome back to Focus.
Thank you. What an honor.
It is great to have you back. I'm excited. Gene and I had a chance to be with you in Israel, and it's life-changing. I mean, it's grueling. It's not a great way to sell the program, but for me, I'd say, yeah, it's really hard, a lot of hiking, but it's the right thing to do. Hmm. What are you trying to set when people view the series That the World May Know? It's always with a live group, a group that you're taking. What are you doing physically, emotionally, spiritually in the series with those that go and actually experience it? What are you trying to do with them?
For me, the part of understanding God's word is to recognize that God put it in a certain time and place because that's where it best fit. It's true always throughout all history, but it fits into a time and place. So I love to go there or to do it by video to create the setting and say, here's what God put there. Here's the culture. Here's the geography. Here's the topography. Here's the history. How does that help us understand the story that God is bringing out at that particular moment? Reading the Bible in context, I call it. So I want to get an audience that steps away from their modern world, shuts off their cell phones, gets off the bus, hikes a few miles. That always
yes.
takes your mind completely away from what's so important in our lives. And to get back as close as possible into the world of the biblical story as it would have been then. And then to read God's word. And to discover there is power in that setting. I liken it to a diamond. You know, you can buy your wife a beautiful diamond, but it's the setting that makes that diamond stand out in all its glory. And the setting God picked does exactly that to his story.
That is a great analogy. You place a lot of emphasis on God's people influencing culture and being God's messenger to bring the good news of Christ. I mean, that's really it. In fact, on that trip that we joined you on, I walked away profoundly impacted by many things you said, but one thing that has stuck with me is that when sin entered the world, chaos entered the world, and Jesus came, and we Christians come to bring God's shalom, his peace, into that chaos.
You know, I start always my teaching, whether it's in school or in Israel or anywhere else, with God's story. He starts the story in Genesis with the earth formless and empty, tohu vavohu, you say in Hebrew, which means chaos. Now, I believe he created all things, so whatever is there, he's created, but it's in a form of chaos, and God speaks to the chaos, and out of the chaos came shalom, this beautiful creation of ours. Then the other power, the evil one, who loves chaos, hates shalom, enters the picture, seduces our ancestors into believing that God's shalom really isn't, and God's magnificent creation slowly moves back into chaos again. God came, and he didn't destroy it and say, that didn't work, I'll do something else. God came and said, I'm going to restore it. I'm going to restore people. I'm going to restore all things, Paul says in Romans. And I'd like you humans, the very ones who brought chaos to my world, to become my partners. I want to use you. Oh, it'll be my spirit, my book, the encouragement of my community. I want to use you to put shalom on display in this chaos world of ours so that people are drawn to shalom. And as they're drawn to shalom, are drawn to me as the giver of shalom.
And when I hear that, I'm leaping inside because that too. Gives you purpose. That in a life of modernity that is mm-hmm. so purposeless, mm-hmm. it helps Christians begin to define why we're here.
Right.
I mean, in that one sentence, bringing God's peace to chaos, mm-hmm. I get it. I know what I need to do now.
Amen.
Every morning I wake up. This has been great to kind of set the tone for set 15, where you're talking a lot about Paul and Silas and the missionary journeys of Paul. That's what I love. You bring things that have happened in the scripture right to modern day application. So when you look at Paul standing before the court in Philippi, what sticks out to you in those stories? What grabs you and says, I can apply this to my life today?
That's such a good question. And I sit here and it's a little bit frustrating in a way, because that's a question that I'd like about an hour and a half.
You're a teacher.
Because it gets right at the heart of the matter. So when Paul and Silas arrive at Philippi, there are two kingdoms in a way, one representing the kingdoms of this world with a very different set of standards and beliefs and gods, and one the kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The fact that those two kingdoms met in Philippi really moved me deeply, because that's where we all ought to live. We ought to be living in this world with all of its kingdoms claiming allegiance of all kinds of things, but we claim the allegiance that we give our allegiance to Jesus Christ alone. And if we live that consistently, we're going to have the same problems Paul had.
Well, RVL, let me ask you this, just for clarification. Why was the Roman Empire, with this lone missionary, Paul, why would they have even taken notice of him? Why did it become a conflict?
Okay.
What was he saying that was so offensive when he's preaching peace, love your neighbor, love one another, love your God?
And really what you're asking is what's in set 15, because I'd love to have the whole 2.5 hours. That's what we exactly unpacked in each lesson, because there are five stories in Acts 16 and 17 that we look at. But let me draw something out of there and give you an example. After Paul had been in Philippi for a while, a small group of people had become believers. So now there's a community of faith who's living out an example of what it is like to live for Jesus. In that context, there's a young girl, and this was one of those moments I wept as I unpack this story the first time. There's a young girl, a slave girl, and the word there, she's probably 6, 7, 8 years old, who is owned by a consortium of people. And she was brought, apparently, to the pagan temple of Apollo somewhere. And they invited the demonic spirit of Apollo to enter her and to take over her. Now, Apollo in their world, think the oracle at Delphi, which is the main center of Apollo worship. Apollo was believed to grant the right to some to predict the future. So this little girl would go around giving ecstatic utterances, which either she or her owners would interpret to tell you what was going to happen in the future. And they made a lot of money doing that. She latched on to Paul. And the Bible says she began to follow him around, yelling day and night, these men are followers of the Most High God. They're telling you a way to be saved. Now, that sounds really religious, really Christian almost. But Most High God to that audience could have meant anybody from Jupiter to, if you're Egyptian, to Amun-Ra.
Sun God, moon
God. Exactly.
Right.
So she's just saying they're claiming a Most High God and saved there. To a Greek or a Roman, wouldn't have meant save from your sins and go to heaven. It would mean the God will preserve you from some problem. And the Bible says, and I love the King James translation here, I think it gets at the nuance of the word, that Paul was grieved in his spirit at this little kid who is being used by her owners to make, imagine, filled with this demonic power. So he confronted the girl, but he didn't speak to her. He spoke to the spirit and commanded that the spirit come out of her, which it did. Well, now she couldn't predict the future anymore. Her owners were furious because in the Roman world, my property is far more important than the life of someone else. So they aren't overjoyed that this little girl is back to normal.
She's lost her value to them, right?
She's lost her value to them. So they drag Paul into the agora, into the heart, the city center of Philippi, and they bring him to the bema, which is the official platform where justice is administered. And they accuse him of teaching things contrary to Roman custom and practice. So they beat Paul within an inch of his life, and Silas as well. They have them flogged, which is a brutal, brutal treatment, something like was done to Jesus. His may have been more extreme, but they were beaten. Their backs would have been bloodied and shredded, and then thrown into the inner prison and placed in stocks. Now, stocks in a Roman world were used, they would put your feet in this implement and then stretch your legs apart until your legs are ready to come out of joint.
Ugh.
Now, the question that raises for me is, why didn't Paul use his Roman citizenship? You
right.
can't do that to a Roman citizen.
Hmm.
Somehow he was dressed as a Jew, he acted like a Jew, he's accused of being a Jew, but nobody knows he's a Roman. He could have gotten out of that treatment by claiming his Roman citizenship. Now, why in this case doesn't he claim Roman citizenship when 7 years later, when he's brought in front of the Roman authorities in Caesarea, he claims Roman citizenship
right up, yeah.
and even the right to go to the emperor? Well, let's go a little farther with the story. He's put in prison, which was a frightening thing. Prison for Romans was not a penalty. That's not a punishment. You're put in prison until we can decide what we're going to do to you. So the likelihood is when you're put in prison, what's going to happen tomorrow is worse than what happened today.
Mm.
But he still doesn't declare his Roman citizenship. In fact, the text says about midnight, Paul and Silas, now imagine his legs may have been stretched to the point of coming out of joint. His back is shredded. Nobody's caring for him. He's sitting in this awkward position in the inner cell, it says, of the prison. He and Silas were praying and singing hymns.
Mm.
Now, I thought about that for a while, and then I remembered Psalm 119, which says, though the wicked may bind me, at midnight I will sing your praises. And I wonder if Paul thought, you know what? The Bible says when they do this to us, we're going to do what the Bible says. We're going to praise God. I often thought Paul's laying there in serious pain, and he says, Silas, I can't sleep. Let's sing a number. You got one?
Yeah, right.
I don't think so. I think Paul is sitting there saying, Silas, the Bible says when they bind you at midnight, sing God's praises. Let's sing. Well, as they were singing, it says the other prisoners were listening. But there was somebody else listening too, because suddenly God sent an earthquake. And if you're familiar with your Bible, you know that at dramatic moments in history, like Jesus' resurrection or his death, earthquakes hit. And the earthquake leveled the prison. And the prisoners were all free to go, to run. Paul and Silas could have run, but they all stayed. There they sat. They were free to go. The jailer came running in, thinking the prisoners had escaped, and by Roman law, his life was finished. He was going to be executed. You can't lose a prisoner. So he came running in with his sword, ready to kill himself. Now, why would he want to kill himself? Well, maybe to be spared the torture that he could expect from his superiors when they discovered the jail was empty. Some scholars, and Costas, the advisor I had, was one of them. He said, I don't think so. In Roman law, if you're accused of a crime and executed for it, your family is sold into slavery, and you lose everything. But if you commit suicide, that's considered honorable. Your family will survive, and they will inherit your property. I think it's more likely that man, not a believer, had morality enough in his heart to say, I'm going to protect my family with the last thing I do.
Huh.
And Paul said, don't do it. We're all here. And the impact of this man realizing, I had him beaten within an inch of his life. I put him in the stocks. I didn't treat his wounds. But he still protected my life by not running away. He risked his life for me.
Mm.
Was so profound that he lays himself at Paul and Silas's feet and says, what must I do to be saved? Now, I don't think saved there means what Christians mean, because he wouldn't have known anything about sin and any of that. I think saved means, what must I do to be delivered from this world of mine? My commander wouldn't have done this for me. Jupiter wouldn't have done this for me. What you did for me, even though I don't deserve it, what must I do? And then it says, and Paul went to his house and taught him the word of God. So now he had to explain what being saved means. My point, though, back to your question, notice what it was that impacted the jailer. The earthquake didn't convert him. It was the realization that Paul would risk his life for someone who didn't deserve it.
Yeah. Right.
And I even wonder, and this is just RVL's question, so if I'm not suggesting it's anything profound, I wondered why the other prisoners stayed.
That had to be the
Were
impact.
They so affected by Paul and Silas singing in the middle of the night to their God that they wanted to become part of that?
Hmm.
I don't know. Anyway, to cut to the chase, the next morning, the officials from the town sent word to the jail, and Paul is still there, and said, let him go. I don't know if they thought the earthquake was a sign from their gods or what. And Paul says, what? I'm a Roman citizen. You beat me without a trial, and now you're just going to say, go away? I want an official apology and an escort. And now he declares his citizenship. When it isn't going to do him any good, it's not going to prevent his beating, it's not going to prevent him from being in prison.
Yeah, he'd be free.
He'd be free.
Now, why?
That's a good question. I think, and this is an opinion I found from a number of different thinkers all the way back to the early church, Paul wanted the validation of his message to be not, I'm a Roman citizen in this Roman city. I don't want you to listen to me because I'm Roman.
Right.
I want you to listen to me because of the validity of the message.
Right.
But now that you've heard the message and it's been validated by God himself, now I'm going to declare my citizenship because in this town is a little community of believers, a slave girl, a jailer, his family, Lydia, the dealer in purple, and her family. And that's a risky business to be believers in a Roman city like this. And I think Paul is covering for them. I think Paul is saying, if anything happens to that little community, I'm going to go to the nearest governor and I'm going to tell him what you guys did to me as a Roman citizen. And I think Paul is providing some protection for the believers. So in this case, he chooses not to use the very citizenship that in another case is what he does in order to get to see the emperor himself.
RVL, this is flying by. And I love this kind of history and background. And the question we need to end with now, today, and we're going to come back next time, but the question right now is, how does this apply to me? How do I find the power in my relationship with God to not put myself first, to not be focused on my comfort, my security, but to say, in essence, Lord, use me. Paul praying and singing in prison. How many of us believers today would be able in our Christian maturity to be able to do that rather than complain, this food's horrible, whatever it might be. And I'm saying that application so that we can get that aha view into everything you just shared. How does it impact me?
See, it seems to me that it's easier for us as followers of Jesus to want to speak the message of shalom, the message of salvation in Jesus. It's much harder to be the message. And it seems to me what Paul is demonstrating there is he didn't tell the jailer to believe in Jesus. He went into the jail and lived it in a specific situation so that as others saw what it looks like when you have shalom in your soul, they wanted in. You know, it's the Ruth story. Ruth is a Moabite. She is, according to the book of Deuteronomy, an outsider for 10 generations. But somehow, she meets her mother-in-law, Naomi, and her father-in-law, Elimelech, and they tell her about the God of Israel. But I can tell you, if they didn't also live consistently God shalom, she would not have been drawn to the God of Israel. If they would have been cold and uncaring and ungodly, she wouldn't have been drawn to Naomi's God. But she was so taken by those two people and their faith somehow, that she said, I want your God to be my God. I want your people to be my people. And that's always been God's way. Yes, we tell about Jesus, but we tell about Jesus more by who we are and how we live than we do by what we say. And this was the struggle I had in my soul as we walked through Philippi for 2 weeks and put this all together. The struggle in my soul was, it's so easy in the culture I live in to think the way to bring about Christian influence is by power, by politics, by economics. Now, all of those things belong to God, and we ought to be working as hard as we can for righteousness in every one of them. The way you shape a culture is by living out the message of shalom in your marriage, in your family, in your business, in your recreation. And as others see it, like the prisoners in the jail, they're drawn to God.
And the difficulty there, RVL, is how to, you have to invite the Holy Spirit to inform you in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And it is this internal battle between our flesh and the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And what do we do to put our flesh in a healthier place? Mm-hmm. Because if someone cuts you off on the road, I'm talking to the listener right now. There it happened. That fleshly response comes out. How do we bridle ourselves like Paul did and respond so a person will say, wow, what do you have that I don't have? Because I would have reacted in an entirely different way than you did. Exactly. That's the point of the jail story.
You know, I find that it's much easier for us, starting with me, to believe that Jesus is my Savior and to know my eternal future is cared for, is taken care of by His grace, than it is to become a disciple. A disciple is someone who imitates his or her rabbi. Mm. And it's much tougher to go into life and say, okay, I believe in Jesus, but now I'm going to have Jesus' faith as well. I'm going to live the way Jesus did. But it strikes me what helps students is as they begin to realize that the way in which God wants us to influence our world is by being the message. God said to Moses, go to Pharaoh. You will be as God to Pharaoh. So when Pharaoh saw Moses, he got a glimpse of what God was like. That's what God wants from each one of us. So I find when I'm on the road and I can tell this guy's going to cut me off, if I can just get my mind to say, RVL, you're here to be the message. You're here to catch a glimpse of what God is like. You can't say that. You can't do that. You can't. It doesn't always work, to be honest, but it helps.
Right. And I think that's the point. We so often want to respond in a worldly way. It's true. Mm-hmm. And even Christians, we're not perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to have slips, probably depending upon the level of the grievance, right? Mm-hmm. But how much better to respond as Paul and Silas illustrate for us, to respond with God's character, God's love, but you have got to bridle your human appetite for revenge, for striking back, and that can be really hard. RVL, man, the time has flown by. I love the storytelling. I get excited about this, John, and I think you can see that.
Mm-hmm.
And it has an impact on you if you're sincere in hearing the message and hearing the teaching and applying that. And we don't have to fight. We don't have to, as Paul did, he didn't go right at Rome, say, change the emperor. The emperor's horrible. How many people with whatever administration in this country you want to support, how many people complain about that? Let's do what we can do at the local level that will impact the national level by being Jesus in the culture.
Amen.
That's the message, and I love it.
And that's the kind of message you're going to find in the latest That the World May Know DVD, A Clash of Kingdoms, Set 15. We've got it. You can learn more at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or call 800, the letter A, and the word family, 800-232-6459. Well, if you enjoyed what Ray Vander Laan has shared today, let me encourage you to make a generous donation to Focus on the Family today, and we'll send a complimentary copy of Set 15, A Clash of Kingdoms. We want you to have that DVD, and when you join our support team, we'll send that to you as our way of saying thank you for being a part of what Focus on the Family is doing and a way of getting this message out. Join us again next time as we have more from Ray Vander Laan and once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.